Hello, I'm Jack Rickard. This is EVTV. I'm here with my compadre and consigliere, El Reino Noto.
Hey, good afternoon, everybody. It's Friday.
It is Friday.
Yeah, it's Friday.
we hardly have a show. It's Friday. We've kind of made the vernal equinox.
Yes.
It's spring.
It is. Yeah, I think, Wednesday. Or Tuesday was spring, we're there.
So. We're kind of getting into the same pattern we had last spring of just rolling series of tornadoes.
Yeah, the weather's been kind of crazy.
Is there something with this global warming thing that I don't understand?
I don't know, I kind of like it though.
Well,
we missed winter completely.
What do we have for news?
You know, I couldn't scratch up a lot this week. Let's see, what
happened?
Here,
if you need to read, I think I'm wearing your
glasses. Oh, that's okay, no, I've got it. I know, I couldn't find it. It goes, I found them under a pile of junk out there.
I have some neat glasses out there, Brian's.
Well, what has happened? Let's see, so I guess the volts, I guess they're going to replace all the 110 power cords on them. It really doesn't say why. They're just saying that they're not robust enough, I guess. So something happened with their the cords for the one. I don't know what.
You know what? I found our 110 power cords aren't robust enough either.
I know.
That's why I like the J1772 connectors.
Yeah. No, we had one blow up on my hand the other day plugging something in the power cord.
So to get into the standard, it's
just better.
This is the 50,000 insertion connector.
Yeah, right. It's a nice connector. Yeah, those little extension cord things. Yeah, one blew up and popped in my hand the other day. It was an interesting beginning of the morning.
Yeah, we've had some stuff like that. They've shut down their production line, but they're saying that in Europe they have 7,000 pre-orders for the, what do they call it? Ampera?
It's the Opel Ampera. Yeah, yeah, and, yeah. That's what they're saying, that they are predicting it may actually outsell the Volt, but I guess, fuel's expensive there, too.
Just don't give up, guys. There's people out there that like those cars. I can tell you that they're just waiting on eBay for them to come in at $30,000, And you'd be surprised, it'd be a whole different thing. It's that value proposition again. That's not a $40,000 car. But at $30,000, you'd have a whole different
story. Yeah, that's a different story.
At $20,000, I believe you could move some of them.
I think they'd sell. Yeah, it would change everything.
So,
hang in there.
Think about it. It might be a place to be to occupy the turf and be developing the line as those CAFE standards increase. But you might find yourself, if we go to a sudden increase in gasoline prices, you'd be in the catbird seat,
right?
You had a line active. So it's not all about the development costs. You might put in a little development into moving the iron at maybe less than you're doing now.
Yeah.
And similarly with the Leaf, we've got viewers, of course. See, this is also incestuous, and people don't understand this. The OEMs and the it's a small community. It's our viewers that build the cars. They're also the same ones that buy the Leafs and the Volts. And the Renault has their Zoe out. Coda has shipped
Coda start to ship a couple, two, three now.
We go has shipped 36.
30 some cars, So, and Think is still building them out there, even though they're banked.
I think all of this is going to change with two events this year. One is the rollout of the Tesla Model S, which is going to be a game changer.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yep.
And two is if they close the Straits of Hormuz, or the Iranians will go to trying to affect our elections, no telling what could happen to the price of gasoline.
Yeah, well, we know which way it'll go.
Well, right. It's probably not going to go down.
Probably not going to go down, huh? And you know, Chevy or GM has also, in California at least, kind of gotten on our bandwagon. Maybe some of their marketing guys are watching our show, that they are actually loaning Volts to people now for 3 days, 5 days, 7 days. They're just giving them the keys and letting them drive it, and they understand that driving the car is the best thing, way to market that vehicle.
As Elon Musk is going to bring changes, the whole way that they market automobiles is due for an upgrade.
Oh yeah, that whole dealer system is
old. The dealer system is part of the problem, and that's the tail that wags the dog now.
Yeah.
The dealers have got that enshrined in law.
Right, so exactly.
Where General Motors can't do this.
Yeah, right.
You should be able to get online and configure everything about your car, your color, everything that goes into their production cycle. And in 9 days or 6 days,
whatever long it takes.
A car come out with your colors and your selection options and so forth.
All of your specifics,
It just goes on to a carrier and goes to your driveway. You don't need all these middlemen. This is the internet. This is what I've been preaching. It's not necessary. And all that adds cost.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and that's a whole other layer. Uh-huh. Yeah.
Some of the issues. Of course, you have service issues and so forth.
Yeah, I mean, somebody's got to work on them, but yeah.
What else happened this week?
Let's see. Our friends out at Ecotality, mm-hmm. they make the charges. I think that's Blink Network and all that stuff. I guess they got a subpoena from the for insider trading from the SEC. So they've got, I don't know exactly what it was talking about. They really don't understand because nobody's seen it. Mm-hmm. But they named a couple of the board members, four employees, including the CEO of Ecotality. So that'll be interesting to see what happens there.
It's getting to be a rough.
And they received some money, too.
Yeah, I think. Did they?
Yeah.
Are they on the dole as well?
Yeah, $126 million.
This is an emerging story, all these companies that money went into. Inner Dell, who was hooked up with Think,
right,
is going to wash out this bankruptcy and spin off InnerOne, the battery company, has got new investors, about $85 million worth.
Okay.
And so everybody that had stock loses everything.
Loses everything, yeah.
And the technology goes to some other guys.
So somebody else
that put in new money.
Yeah, right.
It's always amazed me that could
happen. Yeah, they just wipe you out of it.
You can invest in a company, and they somehow wash it away, but the company goes on. All the people working there go on. It's just they keep your money, and they get new money.
They get new money.
And General Motors did this.
Yeah.
Well, they're shareholders, and it just does not quite make sense. The only ones taking a haircut are the people
who were the investors. Yeah, Jesus.
But that's that's what's going on there. A123's down to $1.50.
Yeah, they were $1.60
share on their stock. Tesla's been trading at highs. They're gonna, and they're the third most shorted stock on the NASDAQ. And Elon Musk has gone public and said, it's going to sting. You're really going to regret this one.
It's going to hurt. It's going to hurt, baby.
His first rodeo on the IPO
stock
market
That's right.
The ground is kind of littered with the people that have messed with him on this deal.
I think so. That didn't go with the bet. Didn't bet on the right side, huh?
Yeah, Tucker did go bankrupt, and indeed DeLorean did too.
Yep.
You just go out and short a few more shares of stock.
That's right.
I'll buy them.
Yeah, that's right. Somebody will buy them. Oops.
Come fall, one of us is going to be right.
Yeah, that's it. That's it.
I'm hoping for a free Tesla out of it.
That's right. Hey, it may work.
I think so. I think I'm pretty much there now. The we had a interesting release this week, and that was let's show them the Escalade first.
Okay, all right.
They want to know about the Escalade. What have we done on the Escalade?
All right. Well, let's just go ahead and bear it all and let them know.
We'll talk about the Escalade.
Okay. Good.
Brainerd mounting is going slowly.
Yeah.
Everyone is kind of disappointed that we're not moving faster.
Sorry.
I'm old. My knees don't work. We have to wait on parts. I got two in.
I saw these
this week.
Yeah, these are cool.
This is from Level Zero Motorsports.
Yeah, and we've used these before, these guys. The Cobra.
Yeah, but these are
bigger. These are much bigger, yeah.
I found some bigger ones on eBay.
Yeah, these are cool.
This is for a Chevrolet Corvette Pontiac GTO.
Okay, we'll take that.
I didn't even know Corvette made the Pontiac GTO.
I didn't, me either.
Polyurethane motor engine mounts. These were $142 for the pair, a little pricier,
man.
But they're bigger in diameter.
Uh-huh. They're
and
nice.
Taller.
Yeah.
Show me how that's gonna fit on there.
Well, what we're gonna do, and we'll need some longer bolts, but our plan is to use the stock motor mounts.
Mm-hmm.
And these are gonna go right on there. There's already a hole that's mm-hmm. drilled in there, and they'll be at a slight angle like that.
Okay. And this bolt is not going to be long enough.
We're going to need about another inch. Yeah, there's a.
That's
there's
okay. A, yeah. I don't know. What is that? That's a grade 8 bolt, I guess.
Yeah.
I think we can do better maybe at McMaster. We need a little longer bolt.
Yeah.
And this is going to hold. Well, it isn't really going to hold 440 pounds, but it kind of will.
I mean, it kind of is. I mean, and when it's really going to hold it, I think, is when it wants to twist.
What you know? I'd like to do is use this. Because this is a big, heavy piece of pig iron, and we could put that on there.
Uh-huh.
Here's the problem. We're at an angle. We would have to bend this.
Right.
I don't think I've got anything that will bend that.
I don't think so either.
In any sort of concise fashion. So
I don't either.
This is the idea, but this is like, this is 5/16 inch
yeah,
thick.
Yeah, that's thick,
it?
Yeah. I'll get us another piece, yeah,
a
couple pieces of stock.
Lighter, a little lighter than this,
yeah.
But not a lot.
No.
And then that's going to sit on here like this, but this will be bent vertically.
It's
like going
to have a little, yeah, we'll have to have a little angle on it. Yeah.
I think that'd be a good thing.
Mm-hmm.
And then hopefully it'll be long enough. I think that's not going to be a problem.
I don't think that's going to be a problem.
In fact, we may actually wind up with some sort of a slider going up and down it to made it to, where's your bar?
Right here. This is the bar that we showed him last week, or he's going to go onto the studs.
If I get too frenetic, it's what he chases me around the shop with.
That's right. And it's going to be somewhere like about here. Then you figure the center of the motor is about right here.
Mm-hmm.
And this is a nice piece of tube.
Our motor mount strikes 13 inches
mm-hmm.
in from the faceplate.
From back here at the transmission sort of face.
And so it's not going to be centered, but that's okay. It's also going to be attached to the transmission.
It's also right now it is. Yeah.
And so we'll have 400 pounds. But it will resist this way.
Right, and it's going to, all the weight's just
sitting
down on it.
And the weight will be down on it, I think.
I think that'll do it.
Yeah, don't go too light.
No, I'm going to go as light as I can that we can bend, but it's going to be a.
And we need the best bolts we can get.
Yeah, we'll get some long bolts. And
yeah, but a little longer than these. These don't quite go through all the way.
No.
We need another inch on these, what are those, half inch?
Yeah, that's a half inch bolt.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And that ought to do. If you get some good grade eights, and because it's, I mean, really the weight is going to be on this thing, top
right,
and
not
bottom.
On the bolt, yeah.
The bolt just needs to secure it. So that's, boy, I'd like to use these, but we'd have to heat that up to a Brazilian degrees and get a big hammer.
Yeah, right. And then we might take some of the strength out of it.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, so I'll get us another piece of stock on Monday morning.
Let's talk about our torque converter.
Okay.
Since we don't know what we're doing, we've got kind of a trick torque converter with the other one. But this one's the one in a car. The ECU set up for it.
Mm-hmm. It is.
I want to try to keep with that.
Okay.
And here's the problem. We've got three holes. Our flex plate, is it set up for those three holes?
Well, it's set up for six, so we could use those three. Yeah, there would be holes either every 120 degrees or 60 degrees, so we're
okay.
Fine. Yeah.
And then our tachometer pickup.
Mm-hmm.
Uses two magnets right now.
Yes, it's using they're 180 degrees apart.
I don't want to throw this out of balance, even though these are very small magnets.
Mm-hmm.
So I want to use three magnets.
Okay.
But we're going to turn one of them around.
Okay.
See, it only works off the south face.
Right. Well, yeah, we know. Yeah, we know that. It's a tough find in that side.
So we'll wind up with two pulses per revolution. But they're not going to be 180 amps.
No, they're going to be, what is that?
120.
Yeah, they're going to be 120.
I think it'll work.
Okay.
We may have to
do a little
calibration.
Yeah, there you go.
We'll put that thing and see what we're being read and what our real is.
Right. Yeah, with our RPM counter, yeah.
Yeah.
Our handheld, sure. Okay.
And so that'll give us some idea what's going on there.
Okay.
And I think that'll be close enough for government work, I hope.
Yeah, we'll find out.
So we'll put one on top of each of those bolts. But one of them, and I've got them, the south side painted red, but it rubs off. So
it does
be careful.
Rub off, I know. I'll check it.
And then one of them turned around the other way.
Yeah. Okay.
And it really doesn't matter which one, obviously. They're equidistant.
No, and at least this time I had to do them on the bench. Last time I could put them on the bolts before they go in. I can glue them on.
One of the things that has us slowed down was kind of a big brouhaha with George Hamstra of Net Gain Motors.
Hi, George.
And Tom Brunka of Hellwig, who makes the brushes for
that.
Yes,
that's what you were
motors.
Saying. Yeah, you've been talking to them the last couple of days.
It's uncertain. And the reason it's kind of uncertain is because of where we're at in the EV world.
Okay.
Rebirth Auto and some of these guys in Florida, like they did that Daniel... He was at the EV.
He was at the Daniel Y. Yeah, yeah.
Porsche Cayenne.
The Cayenne, yep.
That's a heavy car.
Yes.
We've been driving a Ford Edge with an 11 inch. That's a heavy
car. That's heavy.
5,000 pounds. Yeah. This is going to be 8,000 pounds. Yeah. Two 11 inch motors. We're in an area that not much has been done with EVs before.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, we're kind
it's
of treading new ground
little
here.
Little Datsuns and Volkswagens and Speedsters and Mini Coopers, and we're starting to work an end of the world that is very awkward, particularly for brushes.
Oh, okay.
Now, they've been making brushes for 80 years.
Yeah.
Nobody's been using them to drive Escalades.
True enough, yeah.
The Net Gain has been using what's called an H49 brush.
So that's what comes in the motors when they come out to you, okay.
Yep, that's what they've been using for several years.
Okay.
And of course they went to the new red top split Hellwigs in an H49. What an H49 means, as best I can tell, is kind of a soft brush that builds up a very nice lubricating film of graphite on the commutator.
On the commutator, yeah, okay.
Which provides some electrical resistance and some lubrication and is very good for intensely high current loads.
Okay, okay.
Now, a little bit on the history of Net Gain's warp motors. George was in a team of people who had a drag racer called Bad Amplitude.
Right, right.
And they were doing innovations in forklift motors because he lives like 12 or 15 miles from Frankfurt, where...
Warfield?
Warfield Motor Company.
Yeah, right, right, yep. Yeah, he's close to him.
That makes the Net Gains. He's in Lockport.
Right.
And so he started working with them and developed a number of changes to make them sturdier for drag racing.
For drag racing application, okay.
By the way, they still sponsor drag races. George is no longer involved in actually a racing team, but he sponsors some. Mm-hmm. And that's their roots.
Right, in drag racing, yeah.
And so that's the... the thing, Rebirth and some others have recently burned up a couple of sets of brushes.
Oh, okay.
I suspect they've done it with a big soliton controller that can put out 1,000 amps.
Yeah.
And then done it by hauling a big-ass car down the freeway
like
at 250 or 300 amps continuously.
Yeah.
Which these motors are really... an 11-inch, about 225 or 250 for 1 hour is the rating. The reason we can put all this current through when we're accelerating is it's for 10 seconds.
Right, it's just a burst, yeah.
Right. Yeah. But if you go off down the freeway...
You end up in a heavy vehicle like this, yeah.
And you're dragging that, well, it gets worse. One thing, the 849s, the soft brushes, I'm going to call them.
Okay.
And there's a softer one yet for under 84, under 80 volts, the H234, 254, for forklifts and pumps and stuff.
Okay. Just kind of idling along almost, yeah.
Just lower speed, lower voltage, yeah. But softer brushes, okay. But they work real well. But the H49 is a fairly soft brush. He has an H60, which is kind of a newer brush. It's 2.5 times harder, more brittle, harder graphite.
Okay.
Now this could
go 49.
Yeah, this could go a couple hundred thousand miles, and would handle. Believe it or not, the problem is not the 1,000 amps; it's the 20 amps.
Oh, really? And can't handle lower amperage, huh?
Well, right. It really doesn't like that. And then, like I say, this middling range where you're doing a continuous middling amperage.
Right, okay.
And so for longer life, they have one called the H60.
Okay.
And there is some thinking that that would be a better street brush, and particularly for a large vehicle such as this.
Okay. But they don't know for sure? This has never been done.
Well, we're kind of plowing new ground,
yeah,
Brian.
Yeah, they really don't know.
How we make brushes? They're mostly for pumps and forklifts and stuff. That's what the stuff's used for.
That's where all the application is.
Nobody does Escalades. We're the first Escalade in the country. It's electric. One guy did a Hummer, you know. We're kind of showing off here.
Yeah.
Although I think I'm going to like the car if we get it to shift right.
Yeah.
But it's kind of new ground. So is a Porsche Cayenne. A 4,000 or 5,000 pound
car
has not been the way EVs have been done.
Right.
Okay? It's just not been the gig.
No.
So we're out in a new area. There's a reason they don't know.
No one's done them. Right.
But the thinking is that the 860, and so they're going to send us a set of 860s. We can change those brushes probably on the bench pretty good.
Yeah, I mean, if we can get to all of them, if not, we can. When we take it off the bench, we can get to the lower ones, sure.
Right.
But we can get to them.
Yeah, we may have to take it off the bench and roll around on the bench top.
Yeah, but before we get it in here,
We can't do it after we get in there.
No.
This is an all-wheel drive unit right here.
Yeah, we got a whole bunch of stuff in here.
It's not even like the Cobra. It's pretty ugly.
Yeah.
And this one's going to be tough to make an easy maintenance.
Yeah.
When you got to pull the whole front clip off to do anything.
You got to walk inside of it
to do anything. Kind of like the Mini Cooper.
Yeah.
And so, this brush issue, number one, you can't order a net gain motor by brush.
Oh, okay, yeah.
Anyway, so you have to replace the brushes.
You have to replace the brushes after you get it.
They may change them after the current stock is sold out to the 860. Here's the problem with the 860. That's where you get into the 10,000 mile break-in.
Holy moly.
It takes a long, because it's a harder brush,
yeah.
It takes a long time to really get it seated. Get it the 849s kind of seat right in.
Okay.
We've been seating these.
Yeah, little
we've
been seating
these. 30 hours on the motor.
Probably.
And it's cooled down, quieted down to deadly silent.
Yeah, no, it sounds much better and it's much cooler, yeah.
I think I'd probably like the H49s.
Yeah.
But.
If it doesn't fit the application. But we don't, but no one knows.
You know, that's right. If the H49 would be a 30,000 mile brush in this, that's not, and the 860 would be 100.
Right.
I would want the 860.
You want the 860s, yeah.
So it's not perfectly seated the first few blocks I drive the car.
Yeah.
We'll keep driving.
That's right.
Eventually it'll
which
get
we do anyway.
Right.
We do a lot of testing.
So we're probably going to wait on the 860s.
Okay.
And of course, you're going to get me some a little bit lighter angle, not much lighter.
No, a little bit.
But we're sneaking up on putting this motor in the Escalade. And so I apologize if we're not maintaining a a pace suitable to your pace.
Yeah, and you want to come and help, you know.
Some people do watch us at 2x speed, you know, because I talk so slow.
What does he sound like?
Well, here's a hint, guys. We've said 45% of our viewers are outside the United States.
Yeah.
That implies that a good percentage of those in the United States and Canada, a good percentage of those, English is their second language.
That's right. They're the ESL.
If you want me to talk like I'm from New York and speed it up, we're going to leave a bunch of them.
That's right. They'll be having to rewind. It'll take them 10 hours to watch it.
Everything looks accidental here. It's not entirely.
Yeah, that's right.
So stay with us. We will get the Escalade done to some level or another.
Right, as we're kind of cruising along.
All right. Okay.
Well, we're working on it as fast as we can.
We're pedaling as fast as we can.
And we're doing like 10 things at once.
And there's we don't know. Yeah. And we never have really worked out a way to mount this motor, but I think we're getting closer.
I think it'll work. Yeah, I think it'll work. Yeah.
But the damn thing's heavy, and I don't want us to hurt ourselves.
No, we'll take our time.
We may have to get another different kind of crane in here, you know that?
I know.
We might not know. Our cherry picker really doesn't quite reach everything we need to do.
No.
Should we buy a bigger crane?
I don't know. What I've been doing is, and we actually this week too had to fix our lift.
Mm-hmm. Did you get that valve?
It's in. Okay. Yep, it's we had a... What did we have with that thing? We had to rebuild the ram because it was leaking, and then we got it fixed. We thought maybe that was why it was losing pressure. Well, there was a leak in the valve, so that's fixed. Now the lift is primo.
Good.
But that took a couple of days to get
some
that.
Some of our equipment is.
Well, yeah, we use it. We use it a lot.
We do. They're also curious about the Fletenem series.
Oh yeah, and
our module.
Yeah, we've been working on that. Yeah, you've been.
I did
after
get
that.
A new shipment of 500.
Yes,
cells
we did.
In this week, from A123, they're looking better and better. They're obviously brand new cells, mm-hmm. with stickers and not a mark on them. And I'm starting to get into the A123.
Yeah, they're pretty cool.
If we can just work out a way to make a module, the module doesn't cost more than the cells.
Right.
Let's take a look.
Okay.
When last we visited our Fletenem series, which is kind of stalled out, frankly, we had just finished our second layer. We have three cells in each thing, times 12 serially, for a 40-volt, 60-amp-hour pack. Capable of probably 1,400 amps. We're actually going to try to put three of these together. This is a little bit better stack. You can see I've kind of got some terminals here. We're going to tie those down here at the loose end by putting a braided strap to this one and a braided strap to the next level, and then bolting those together. Kind of a flexi connector. And one end, of course, we'll get a cable, which will come out through our package, through a gland nut. And at some point, we'll have another end on the other end that'll go out the other way. And that'll be our package. This is kind of a piece of lightweight that'll be in the middle. Over here, we have our original one that we did, and it's the thicker black polycarbonate. I'm adding a frame around it. This is 2-inch by 2-inch, I think 3/16, just aluminum. And I have drilled some holes in here, and I tap them with a hand tap for 1/4-inch bolts. And you just run a hand tap through that. This will go over the end. As you can see, I've already done two on the sides. We'll have another one on this end. And that is going to be our base. This would face down. This would be on the underside of the car. This are our screws, simply attaching the batteries to this material. Understand the batteries aren't clamped to this material. There is a bar and an anvil that I'll show you here. it's something like this, a aluminum bar, is, I call it an anvil, the big piece, and a small piece, which is the clamp, and those are screwed down to clamp the tabs together. The screws extend through this just to physically mount them. This does not clamp the cells at all. It affixes them in their position along this piece of polycarbonate. And so we've got another 12 series, three parallel bank underneath this and inverted. I'm going to build this frame around it, and we'll flip that over and lay the other piece in and connect it. We're going to zero balance all the cells to 2.75 volts and then charge them all together. That would give us 80 volts. We're about an inch and a half thick per each section. And so I've got some 4-inch 0.090 aluminum that we will put inside here and then put another piece of aluminum more or less this way. And this edge would be what would clamp to the car. And we'll offset that as we need to accommodate our height, but it should be about 4.5 inches. 4.5 inches is more than I really care to put under a car, but I have to tell you that it's very tempting to put three layers, which would be 4.5, maybe a little taller than 4.5. Because that would give us 120 volts. And that's what we're using with the AC50 and the Curtis 1238-7601 controller. We have actually ordered a number of those and are gonna offer them on the website. I'm very much taken with this motor and controller pair. The rumored Curtis 144-volt controller is probably going to be ready June or July at this point, it looks like. For me, it's a little bit of a disappointment in that it looks like it'd be nominally 144 volts, just like the one we use now is nominally 108 volts. The top voltage would be at 160 and 170, much as our current one is at 130 and 140. I sometimes have trouble, if I'm above 130, getting the controller to kick on. I can bring it down with the headlights or a heater, and that works fine. It's got a very hard limit at 140. It simply will discontinue operation. But 130 is what I think of as the voltage limit on the 1238, 7501, and 7601. The difference between the 7501 and the 7601 is 100 amps. The 7601 goes 650 amps. And while this new controller is purported to do, as I said, realistically 160 volts, they have derated the current ability to 500 amperes. Now, what I'm going to say from here on, I'm sure the nitpickers are going to go crazy about, and it is true that in an AC three-phase polyphase motor, the situation is somewhat complicated. Roughly, with a higher voltage, we can extend the knee, which, let me put up some of the graphs we did with the 7601 controller and put those up here where you can see them. You can see where the power started to drop off the torque as the RPM went up, and at about 3200 RPM, that was the sweet spot. After that, it went off. With a higher voltage, that could be extended higher. But with lower current, we're not going to make as much torque at the low end as you do at the high. It might surprise you to know that their AC31 motor, the smaller motor, develops higher torque than the AC50 at the low end of the scale. And so to take advantage of this Curtis motor, this new Curtis controller is a little more complicated than plugging it in. They are winding a new motor, but the motor itself is larger at over 9 inches. It's really an 11-inch motor with the casing because it's water-cooled. And so without that motor with it, I don't see much advantage, frankly, in the 145-volt version. It's kind of a disappointment, and I'm surprised that they're going that direction. Had they maintained the 650 amps at 160 volts, this would be a significant increase in power. Dropping back to 500 amps at 160 volts instead of 130 volts at 650 amps, it's about a wash. We're not getting much in overall power gain at all. And so we're probably going to remain focused on the 7601. One of the differences is purportedly the 145 amp device is going to be considerably larger physically than the 7601, and we like that package. We're going to put it together and offer it to our viewers with the motor, the controller, and this pair. We've been a little bit befuddled in the past in that it's kind of picky about the contactor that it uses, or the high current relay that you use to feed it. It has to be a 24 volt kilovac, really. And so in order to make sure you have the right one, we're going to include that. And since I believe the key to long life on these controllers is temperature control, we're increasingly getting into liquid cooling, and we're probably going to include some form of a chill plate with that. We are starting to sell more components. We've sold a lot of the little meters, and I've got 32 more coming in this week. The JLD 404 amp hour meter, and a lot of people are using that to good effect. Damian McGuire did a video about this on YouTube, where he actually used this meter to discover some problems with his headway batteries. And so the meters are actually working out pretty well. We do pretty good value add on that. I wrote a book on it, actually. The documentation was so poor. But we also straighten up the situation with the shunts and give you a little 12-volt to 12-volt DC to DC converter to ensure you maintain isolation. Let's talk just a little bit about these cells that we're using in the Fletenem series. And of course, you watched me make the module with the pink mold. That module is testing very well, by the way. We just got a shipment of 500 of these A123 cells. It's marked made in the USA. They have full tabs that do not appear to even have a scratch on them. And they have a sticker with a serial number that matches the serial number that's on here. It says A123 systems, made in the USA, A1 down here. I don't know what the A1's for, and it does vary, but they appear to be new cells, fresh, and we're finding them testing pretty well. Actually, pretty good. I would call it a 19 amp hour cell, not a 20, which they call it an amp 20 M1HD-A is their designation. But they use slightly different voltages than I do. I think they charge them a little higher, and they discharge them to 2 volts. I'm sorry, we're not going to do that with a lithium iron phosphate cell. 2.5 is the cutoff we'll go to when measuring these. And that looks like, sounds like 19 amp hours to me on the cells. We've picked up another 500 of them, and I'm going to make that available to our viewers since we're kind of have the website going selling the braided straps and the meters. We might as well sell these. We're not going to sell them at a loss. We're going to charge $31 a piece for them. I don't really intend this to be a big deal. It's for our viewers that want four of them or eight of them or 16 of them to play with to try to devise their own module scheme. If that works out, you can go through the brain damage of dealing with Alibaba and the Chinese, doing a wire transfer to China of $10,000 and hoping somebody sends you something, and dealing with the shipping and the customs and the PayPal charges to get all that brought into the United States and delivered to your site. You can save a lot of money. And I'm not going to even quote a price as to what they're going out for right now. I don't know. It changes from day to day. And the traders change from day to day. Subsequent to the James Morrison affair, I'm not even going to provide references to particular traders. I did that to Dale Friedhoff, and he wound up losing $16,000 to Mr. Coy and Morrison. I think it was called Current EV Tech at the time. In any event, we're not going to provide those kind of recommendations anymore, even if we've had good luck with them. I had ordered four times from Coy and gotten good service when he tagged us. And after all that washed out with Morrison and that we had the whole legal thing and the lawyers and stuff, they gave Coy the components. He sold off the batteries again and got us again, cheated us again. It's a terrible thing to get mixed up with that. So you have to be careful who you trade with. But we're going to sell the cells. I think they're reasonably good cells. They put out an immense amount of power. We have tested them to 23C, 475 amps out of one of these cells. Actually, three of them in series, but one wide, for 30 seconds into a constant state load, and they didn't really waver at all. They were doing the job. So very high power, not particularly an advantage density wise, and not really an advantage price wise. By the time you fool with all this. But there is a granularity advantage. They're 20 amp hour cells, and so you can devise smaller packs for shorter ranges at less expense, but they're still able to put out the full power into your controller and your motor. And so you can test your system with like a little 20 mile pack or a 40 mile pack. And if it works out, then invest, and somewhat later, in fact, I'm sure the cells will be less expensive. And so it's kind of an end for a lot of people to play. If you want to experiment, we will make the cells available to you at $31 a piece. You don't have to deal with customs. You don't have to deal with shipping. And we'll take PayPal. And so you don't have to deal with any of that. But the intent is not to make a big profit from our viewership. It's to make available the cells in small quantities for experimental purposes. And if you decide you need 300 cells, then you're back out in the market looking for, price is the usual thing. And so that's what's going on with the A123 cells. We're going to just have to keep plugging on the Fletenem series, and I'll show you what we've got as we get it going on. I've got enough cells now to do my third layer, but we're still working on some of the mechanics of doing the first layer, interconnecting the layers, being able to access the individual cells for balancing purposes, and so forth. But right now, this is just, we're going to build this in aluminum edge that'll stiffen all of this dramatically. Shouldn't add too much weight. Allow us to mount it to the bottom of the car, and we'll have to come up with some sort of sealed system to cover our mounting, because these are live with voltage here. So that's gonna be an issue. The edges are not gonna be live. These will go to the frame of the car. And so that's what we're doing with Fletenem series and A123 cells. Is there anything I didn't cover on the A123s? Not much value add there, guys. They come in a box, I'll send you a box. We're not gonna test them for you ahead of time. If you get one that's obviously bad, I'll probably send you another one, but not much of a manual on it. It's kind of a very simple cell. We just wanna make it easy for you to buy small quantities, minimum brain damage. You can stop in our website, get a cup, coffee cup, a meter, and some A123 cells, and we'll go from there. So that's what we're doing on the A123 modules. It's gonna be an ongoing project, I think, for some time, doing different modules in different ways. Eventually we're gonna try to do a car out of these, and maybe a very light car. And so that's what the interest is for there. Okay, I've got a mess going here. I'm doing 17 things at once. This is for a Kalb 180 amp hour cells that I've been testing in parallel with our original 12 volt module that we made with the form that never did cure. This is our new module that I'm testing as well. And right now we have taken it down to 2.63 volts and balanced it at 2.63. And then we've been charging. We put 107 amps into it. I want to show you, this is our new JLD meter. It's blue instead of red. We have the recharge car amp block here that we're playing with our laptop here that shows us amperes. They're showing about 3 amps below reality. We also have the Valerie Dimitri little board mess that we had before. They've since replaced the board. We followed their instructions and used the little copper bar and hooked it all up. It's still 5 amperes too high on 100 amp, 5%. It's completely unacceptable accuracy, and they don't seem to have a whole lot of interest in that. Right now, I'm using David Riddle Company power supply that'll do 100 volts and 100 amps, I think. 0 to 30 volts and 100 amps. And we're charging at 87 amps right now into this. And we have 108.9 amp hours showing on our meter. Now, that was not taken down that far. We balanced that battery at 2.63 volts. It was not even down to 2.5 static, although under a load it would have been below 2.5 volts. And so pretty much discharged, pretty much 100% discharged. And now we are recharging it. Now, if you'll recall, this is a 6P and 4 in series module made out of the expansive foam. About 4 pounds lighter than this one. This is about 36 pounds. This one's about 32. Other than that, essentially identical. Made from 3 of our things. I am charging at the moment at 3.45, 3.44, 3.43, and 3.44. Very well balanced, actually, because The capacity differences should be showing up here at the top. So we're not quite there, and we've put in 110.6 amp hours. And the current level on our JLD 404 is, we're showing 74.8 there. Let me zero my Fluke. I like this Fluke clamp meter. 73, 72.9, I'm at 72.3, it's moving around, falling, but it's 2 or 3 amps higher than what we're seeing on the recharge car, and our JLD 404 is remarkably in line with both our David Riddle Company power supply and our Fluke meter, and that's kind of interesting. Well, I am on a 500 amp shunt here. We've been shipping these with 1,000. It's slightly more accurate with a 500, but it's unclear to me what happens with the meter and the amp hour counts if you exceed the 75 millivolt limit. And so we've been using them with 1,000 amp shunts, on the assumption that your excursions above 1,000 amps would be very limited. You can use larger shunts, and if you want them, I've got them up to 1,500 amps. And so that's what we're doing. But this is interesting in that we're now at 112 amp hours. My voltages, well, I have cell number one is now up to 3.58 volts, 3.59. Cell number 2 is 3.5. Cell number 3, 3.46. Cell number 4, 3.47. So we're starting to see some differences here at 112.8 amp hours. As I said, we're six cells in parallel. Were they 20 amp hour cells, that would be 120 amp hours. We've got a shot at getting full stack out of this particular thing. And one of the deals that we had was we poured the bottom of this, then we poured that expansive foam, which takes on air, doesn't get as hot as the regular stuff, and then put our regular resin on the top, but in a thin layer. So we never did heat these cells up quite as much as we did over here, pouring it full of the hard resin. And that may have an effect. The heat of these resins is something we're going to have to watch. We're at 113.7 amp hours. And divided by 6, that would be 18.995 amp hours. So we'll see where it goes, but I'm at 3.70 on cell 1. 3.54, 3.48, 3.48. If I did this at 3.65 per cell, like a Thunder Sky, times 4, that would be 14.6 volts on average across the set. I'm at 14.26 here. And so I'll show you kind of what happens there when we do that. We'll just charge that to 14.6 blindly. But when it gets there, I'm going to pull my little cell log and show you how, with the bottom balance and our differences in capacity exacerbated at the top, that the short cell, number one, it appears, is now up to 3.76 volts. 4.2 at 4.3 is where you don't want to go beyond on these cells. I'm at 14.34. We're at 114.8 amp hours. And so this charging cycle is going extremely well. Let's give that a minute. I think we may get up 117, 118 amp hours into this. Our power supply is kind of a constant current, kind of constant voltage, so it's slowing down. We're at 0.33. Let me crank up the voltage just a little bit to get us back up 50 amps or so. We're at 14.5354. I'm going to turn down the voltage. We're going to try to hold it there, kind of at 14.57. 5.78, so we're kind of holding it right under 14.6. My high voltage is 3.87 on cell 1. I've got a 3.69 on cell 2, a 3.52 on cell 3, and a 3.52 on cell 4. So 3 and 4 are still very well matched, but this one is up at 3.87, and that's with them lined up at identical states of charge at the bottom, and then an identical amount of current being forced into them for 115.8 amp hours. And we're at 14.63, and still my highest is at 3.88. No danger. And so that's what we try to do, is charge We're going to use these cells just like Thunder Skies, set it at Calbs, 3.65 volts times the number of cells. And we're going to have some that'll be up at 3.85 or 3.9 and some down around 3.5. It's all good because when they get to the bottom at 2.63, they're all going to be kind of the same thing. And as you can see, I'm at 116 amp hours right now at 14.69 volts. And 116.2 divided by 6 is 19.36 amp hours. That's pretty good with these cells, and certainly close enough for government work. We're at 22 amps and falling, and we can kind of let that ride there a little bit. Let me turn that voltage down just a hair. And that's going to get us down around 14 amps. Now, I charge this kind of quickly, 100 amps. We're down to 14.69 again, 15 amps. Let's go down to 10 amps. 0.05 would be 6 amps or so on this. And there we are at 14.65, 12 amps. I can squeeze a little more in there, but if you notice, my amp hours are going in real slow now when I'm down around 12 amps, 116.5. So we've got the good out of this. It's about 116. I'm going to guess 117 amper is our capacity. So unlike the Chinese cells that we get, they do not understate anything. They call this 20 amp hour cell. We're not going to ever quite get 20 on these A123s. That's why I use 6. We've got a 116 amp thing, and I would be very comfortable using this as a 100 amp hour cell all day. This would make a fantastic battery for a regular car. First place, it'll put out 1400 amps on the 3, so about 2800 cold cranking amps out of this thing. 116 amp hours will let you do that for quite a while, and of course in an automobile, 14.6 volts, which is as much as we want to go here. Most alternators can't do that; they'll do 14.2. And so, as long as you didn't ever let it run to below 10 volts, that battery would last in a car certainly the life of the car. And on those cold mornings, it would still put out a huge amount of current. If the freezing temperatures dropped its output in half, you're still 12 or 1400 amperes. And so that'll spin that starter. Unfortunately, you're looking at 24 of these cells. And at our $31, that would be $750 plus your resin, an $800 car battery. Since you can get them for $65, that doesn't make much sense, but it would certainly make a thing to spin a starter. Anyway, there you have it, 116.8 amp hours, and we're going to call that full. I'm going to disconnect it with this. And that seems to be the a full cell. We have been trying these in parallel with this, and they do come out at different rates as far as the amperes, but at the end they all catch up and work out just fine. So I do not see a problem in mixing these and these. They're actually quite close in internal resistance, these just put out more power. These have higher density, and together they're actually a pretty good combination. I've been watching it with 2 meters, kind of at the end. You'll see one of them discharging into the other one, but within a very few minutes they get it all sorted out. So, not a problem, apparently.
Well, that's progress, yeah. Yeah.
It always surprises me when people like to watch that. I always feel embarrassed when we put this on the thing with me talking about batteries.
Batteries, they love batteries.
Now, I know that batteries are the central issue. It's not that that escapes me, but it's not real good video.
No, it's kind of.
To show a battery charging is like.
Yeah, it's like, yeah. Hello.
Okay, now here it is. Get ready. I know that wasn't too exciting, but we're going to switch it on you. Now we're going to discharge it.
Here's the money shot. Jeez.
Okay, here's a little physical activity. I'll hook some connectors up to it.
With like just a little clip.
Right. So I'm always.
Look, I'm clipping us on.
I'm always embarrassed when we put that in the video, and that's the stuff.
You guys love it, though.
Most.
I know.
But it's just not like.
Yeah, it's not exciting video.
It's not.
No, it's not dancing girls or something or crashes or something.
I should probably just write about it in a blog. But, we had another fortuitous event this week, and I've been thinking about it a lot. Of course, the convention was the highlight of last year.
Mm-hmm.
It really sort of capped off our year and surprised me every stage of it.
Yeah.
And it wasn't that big a deal. It was 100, maybe 128 people came in, and with all of us and our staff and everything, it was like 140.
Mm-hmm.
This was not a big convention.
No, no. Not by what we've done before and not by standards of conventions in general. Yeah.
The trade shows we've done have had many more educational sessions, a lot more people. But it had a lot of energy.
It did. Yeah, it was.
In fact, I've never had one, and I always open them on Wednesday evening. It's just, that's always worked really well. I've never come into my office on the Monday before a trade show opened and found 50 people there.
Oh, I know. Yeah, it's like they're
standing. That's a new one for me.
They're standing outside waiting. Yeah, if they're there, they're in their hotel or doing
Monday
something.
Monday it was 25. Tuesday it was 50.
Yeah.
And by Wednesday, this place is full.
Everybody was here.
And the trade show isn't even scheduled to start till Wednesday evening.
Yeah, right. And that was just kind of a little get-together for the guys who were here.
By the way, I had a whole technical presentation on lithium iron phosphate cells I was going to work on Tuesday and Wednesday.
Right, but there were just people here all the time. Yeah.
Well, and it started Monday.
Couldn't get away. We actually started Monday.
So we didn't even have that session.
No, we didn't do that session, no.
And so, but there was an old guy in a straw hat here named David Kidd from WSIU. SIU is Southern Illinois University. It's right across the river in Carbondale.
Right.
What's that, 45 miles?
Probably, yeah. Maybe
you got steps on it. What's going on?
Yeah, yeah. It takes, like less than an hour to get there.
He wrecked his car, went to sleep on the way over here.
Yeah.
It's not a 45 trouble-free.
He's okay,
miles,
though.
He's all right.
It's 45 minutes if you don't roll your car in a ditch.
Yeah, if you don't roll your car in a ditch, it's 45.
It's a long way if you do.
Yeah, if you stop by the hospital.
That's right.
It's not as much fun as he makes it look.
No.
Good move, Kirk.
Evil Kirk Neville.
Stay awake.
That's right.
So anyway, Cape Girardeau is a university town. We have a Southeast University here. And both of our wives, by the way, teach up there.
Mm-hmm.
And they have this river campus down here. They've got the Trans-Siberian Orchestra in this week.
Yeah, we're doing that.
Something about Lend Me a Tenor.
They got the Chinese acrobats tonight. I'm going to that.
The Chinese acrobats are tonight.
Tonight, yeah, that's right. I am going to that.
And so, we have all kinds of cultural fun stuff. But right across the river, they have another Southern Illinois University. They have their own TV station, which is a public broadcast system. Mm-hmm. PBS is, where you watch the Springbok bait and Nova and that sort of thing.
Right, right.
And so I always like to watch the Serengeti plane dry out. That's a favorite for me.
That's right. Animals eating other animals.
Animals eating other animals at the water hole. As the water hole shrinks.
That's right. They're all sitting. And there's the one alligator. One alligator in the middle. Waiting.
In the Springbok.
Yeah. Yeah.
So anyway, I like public television.
Mm-hmm. And yeah, so, we like public television.
But he came to this event and shot a lot of video, and then I never saw anything.
No, because that was September. Yeah.
This week, March, they aired a 30-minute piece that was about us and about the convention. Big interviews with George Hamstra of NetGain and Sebastian Bourgeois of Ebnetics and Nabil Henke.
Some of the attendees got
Fred Boehning. Fred was here with his Bug Eye Sprite, and they interviewed him. And I hadn't thought about it. Ironically, since we were here, we really didn't have the manpower to video the event.
No, we really didn't. We were planning on it, and it just...
Everyone thinks that...
we had Christopher was the only one that got any video, really. Mm-hmm. And some of you guys did, actually, thank goodness.
Yeah, some of them posted it on YouTube, but... And we didn't have any. If we had, it's a week worth of stuff. How am I going to edit all that down? It'd take me till March,
which it did take David till March.
I mean, we get kind of down into the nitty-gritty of... the whole thing, the building the cars, the politics of it, whole thing. Who are we and what are we about? Well, we know this. Most of our regular viewers do.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
But if you just like tune in one Sunday afternoon to see the latest show, and it's your first time, it
takes a little while to get it.
You kind of got thrown into the deep end.
Yeah, it takes a little while sometimes to get it.
We're a little strange.
But very good.
This was provided kind of an overview of who we are and what we do.
Uh-huh. Exactly.
He stole a lot of my footage to make that, so I'm going to steal the whole thing and put it in this week's show.
I don't think he'll mind.
Let's take a look here.
On this edition of WSIU In Focus, you may not know it, but a region could be ground zero for a potential electric car revolution.
That's because two entrepreneurs and innovators, Jack Reichardt and Brian Noto, decided to set up shop in Cape Girardeau.
From a garage in Cape called ETV Motorworks, they produce a weekly online television series that shows their adventures as they convert traditional gasoline-powered cars into electric-powered autos.
The duo doesn't call what they do television production, but rather publishing and community building. The videos they post tend to be rather long, fairly technical, and a bit quirky, but they've developed a loyal following of people from around the world who watch and blog about the do-it-yourself approach they advocate.
This cyber community of aspiring electric car makers and the folks making products for this fledgling market recently got together in Cape Girardeau for the first ever electric car conversion convention. Our cameras were there to witness what could be the birth of the next big technical revolution.
This is the main part of our facility where we actually do the work on the cars. This is the shop facility. This is the second vehicle that we did here, is a 2009 Mini Cooper. And today it's the subject of part of our show. We've got a few cars that we work on here. We've also got this Porsche replica we did in here. We do all types of work in here, and it's always full of vehicles.
Jack Rickard is the driving force behind this operation where they build and test electric cars, like this electric Cobra prototype. If you ask Rickard what they do, he will not say they're car makers, but rather that he's catering to people who want information and that he's using a time-honored business model to provide it.
We're a publisher. We published a magazine and directory and did trade shows for internet service providers throughout the 80s and 90s, and I sold that in 1998. I recognize the same passion and the same grassroots movement in this group that I saw in the early band of people who actually built the internet. And so I feel very privileged to actually get a second rodeo, if you will, in discovering a group that's working on pretty much the future of transportation, and they're doing it with a great deal of passion. We'll do a TV show for them, a magazine for them, whatever we have to, but we're a publishing outfit.
We see this as an extension of that same publishing model, except for the fact that we don't smear ink on dead trees anymore and send them out in the mail. We really feel that, especially for our audience, about 40% of our audience is out of the United States. They're in other countries, especially countries where gas prices are high, like Europe all over, Australia, Asia, they're very interested in other forms of power for their vehicles. It's just a choice of power plant versus a internal combustion engine is what we talk to people about. And it's just a choice of you having a car that is powered differently instead of burning fossil fuel by using electricity.
As a power source, electricity has many positives going for it.
And electric makes sense because you don't have to build out an infrastructure like you would for hydrogen or natural gas. Electricity is everywhere. The combination of the ubiquity of electricity and the game being changed with the lithium-ion batteries, we really feel that electric vehicles have really got a chance this time.
Lithium batteries are pretty much the news and the enabler for these cars. There have been electric cars for 100 years, and there's been individuals converting cars for the last 50 years. The sea change, or what we call a threshold of viability, is the availability of the lithium iron phosphate cells where we can build the car with an 80 to 100 mile range or more. And that suddenly, instead of building a science project or demonstrating a car, you can actually go into your garage, build a car, and use it as a car. And that's really kind of news the last 3 years.
The type of cars that we're talking about, the lithium ion powered battery electric vehicles, which is really the game changer in terms of making these real cars and perform like cars, is, you know, there are maybe a few thousand in the world of these vehicles. So this is a process that's still going to take years. We're in the tinkerer stage. We haven't even approached early adopters, really.
The early adopter stage is typically classified as 2.5% of a market. That would be 375,000 electric cars a year. There's probably 15,000 electric cars in the world using lithium batteries.
EVTV spends a lot of time testing the ion lithium batteries.
And these are some of the batteries who didn't necessarily survive. Here we've got a battery that has been abused. As you can see, if I put a side view of it, it's swollen. It's got a bulge on each side. And that's an indication that that battery has been overcharged. We're looking with this setup here to abuse batteries for the most part, and to test them and to see if they actually deliver the amp hours and the performance that the manufacturers are stating.
At EVTV, if we murder a battery, either by accident or on purpose, in some sense, we can keep 700 other people from making that mistake, and likewise murdering a battery. And we fall on our sword on the expense of the cell, but several hundred other people don't have to do that then.
Once a week, they shoot enough material to create a program that is 90 minutes or longer. Their setup is simple and the production is basic, but the content is highly technical.
We're setting up the studio. This is the shop portion. This is where we do most of our work. And then we have a little studio up front. And depending on what we're going to be doing for the show, for this show, for instance, we did a lot of work on the Mini Cooper. We found that we had developed a leak. Our pack voltage somehow had found a ground to the chassis. That's a kind of a dangerous situation. If you are touching the metal and you touch the terminal of the battery, you get a shock.
This car, a lot of our cars are fiberglass, but this one's metal. And if you lean across the metal and touch your battery, and one end of it was tied to the frame, you get 380 volts.
Right, right.
And it hurts.
Yeah, it does.
So our pack is actually, our entire drive system is entirely isolated from frame rail.
From the frame, yeah, it's never tied into the frame. And the fix was easy. It was more of the step-by-step how to find it.
To talk cogently about how you can build a car in your garage, we need to build one. And so at this point, we're kind of not only building them serially, but sometimes in parallel, we'll have two or three car projects going on at the same time. Revisit earlier builds as things come up with those. Show what's happening on our new build. and often preview the car we're going to do next and talk about the components, the processes, and the techniques to convert an existing automobile to electric drive. And that's what we're about.
This vehicle is a replica of a 1965 or 66 Cobra from a manufacturer in Granby, Missouri. And we're doing the prototype work for this, the electric vehicle conversion. They have an interest in producing these cars in Taiwan. And right now we have produced it and we are testing it.
An onboard camera lets viewers come along for a ride as they perform a coast down test.
I did some reading about coast down tests and how to do them. And basically we incorporated the concept of running a car up to 75 miles an hour, taking our foot off the accelerator, and putting the gear shift in neutral.
In neutral, yeah.
And calling out a time mark when it crossed through 70 miles per hour. And noting that as time zero. As it descends through 60, we call out a second time mark and note that as the 60 time. And as it gets through 50, the 50 time, and so on down until it rolls to a stop.
And we've basically have compared the difference between the big fat tires that are that you would normally find on a Cobra car and low rolling resistance tires. And we finished that test this morning and we graphed that out.
Yeah, but that's a 31 second difference.
It is. And it does turn out that low rolling resistance tires are in fact a lot better. They do provide less rolling resistance. In this case, maybe 20-25% better rolling. You're looking at a lot of difference, maybe 15-20 miles in terms of overall range.
Electric car converters are hungry for this kind of information, and Jack Rickard breaks it all down for them.
It stands better on those wide tires than on the narrower Michelins, but we're not close. It's not worth the price. This is 60 watt hours per mile difference.
Calculating watt hours per mile is not a trivial exercise. Knowing this number can affect the number of batteries used for a build. It's also vital in calculating the payback time of an electric car. Finding ways to improve this number is a big deal. So despite the long presentation and technical nature of each show, there is an audience that visits EVTV each week for more.
We do the final filming on Friday, edit it on the weekend, and it's usually up Sunday or Monday on Amazon's CloudNet for viewers worldwide. The viewership, and I've got pretty good tools to look at this, has been growing pretty steadily. I think it's something that an increasing number of people are becoming aware of. The internet allows us to reach a wider geography and at the lower costs than normal video production. We can afford to do it for really a narrower audience of people that are quite interested in actually building a car. You know, if a old 57-year-old guy in Cape Girardeau can do this, I can do one too. And so they'll start looking at a little S10 pickup or a Ford Ranger or something and just do their own electric car, and it'll work well enough.
And be perfectly honest, we are here very, very early. I mean, 2 years ago when we really started the show, yeah, the parts guys were out there, they were selling some parts. More of what we're trying to do is get information out to our viewers to build electric vehicles one car at a time, basically, one vehicle at a time. And that's the way we see the world changing. And we also needed to be there early to give the market what it really needs. I mean, a market needs information, and in this case, a video magazine, a publication, to really, in a trade show, to really gel it and to really let people get together and to form a market.
The trade show brought viewers that had been working in isolation together for the first time. They arrived at Jack Rickard's garage for an initial meet and greet. but the conference itself was moved to a hangar at the airport.
We thought that our entire trade show was going to be able to be held in this, 14,000 square foot building, and look at how wrong we were a year later, that we thought that was the market, and the market ended up being 140, 150 people coming to Cape Girardeau.
So why is Cape Girardeau home to EVTV?
The reason Cape Girardeau is because this is where Jack was born here. He was in the Navy, lived in Southern California in Denver, where I met him in Denver. So he came back after being gone for 28 years. This is his hometown.
We're a little bit of an enigma in the local community. I'm kind of the eccentric guy down on the south end of town, and so there's not a great deal of cognizance in Cape Girardeau itself.
I moved here to help Jack with some completely unrelated projects. Jack started fooling around with hydrogen, and we needed a place to store it. That really didn't work out that well, but that got us interested in the lithium-ion batteries. It just seemed like everything that we had done before that led us not only here to Cape Girardeau, but to this market at this particular moment in time.
I would have expected this in California. I never expected it to be in Cape Girardeau, Missouri. I'm just amazed, but here it is. And a good deal of that is because of Jack Rickard, Jack's personality, Jack's drive. He's a big part of the reason that we're here today.
Jack Rickard has made many friends along the way, like Dwayne Ball, whose replica of a Porsche 904 was one of the major attractions at the show.
The 904 is our second EV that good friend and fabricator Scott Smith and I built under Jack Rickard's tutelage through EVTV.me.
It's gorgeous. It's a dream car.
Dwayne was a viewer and called several times with questions, emailed, and we kind of got into a daily correspondence.
Much of this dialogue occurred as Dwayne Ball attempted to build this replica of a 1950 Porsche 550 Spyder. Called a roller, these kits include the body, chassis, interior, axle, transaxle, and brakes.
It all started where we were going to buy a roller and make a little hot rod out of it with a internal combustion engine, and then Scott said, "Well, we've done that before. Why don't we make an electric vehicle out of it?"
While proud of the end result, the satisfaction didn't last long as Dwayne Ball missed the challenge of the build.
And Dwayne wanted to do another car. That's the cure for this sort of empty nest syndrome when your car doesn't need you anymore. And we discussed a roller that, again, a Chuck Beck reproduction that was just coming out of a 1964 Porsche Carrera GTS, the 904. He had quite a bit of money in this car, and that roller was going to be quite pricey. And so basically, I agreed to purchase this one from him, and we'd work with him on their next project, which was the Porsche 904.
If you'll follow me with a camera, we'll walk around the car and I'll kind of show you the build and open her up so you can look inside. George Hamstra from Annette Gang talked us into a Warp 11-inch. We switched controllers to the Evnetics Soliton 1. We used the same 180 ampere hour China Aviation lithium batteries. We have 52 of them in this car. We have 36 cells in the back in four cases and 16 in the front. The biggest challenge is about 50% of the build, Jack would say, is locating space for the battery boxes, building the battery boxes, and installing the boxes. This car has a little more range than the Spyder. The Spyder was maybe a 110 to 120 mile range. We feel this one is probably 130, maybe a little more. I've driven it 110 miles a couple of times, and the percentage left in the pack has led me to believe that it'll go at least 130 miles. We've geared it, and we think the car will probably do in excess of 120 miles an hour anyway.
Dwayne Ball has a net gain motor and Evnetics controller. The presidents of both these companies were invited as speakers. George Hamstra, the keynote speaker, did so well in the computer industry, he retired at age 37 and built an electric dragster just for fun.
We initially started with an off-the-shelf motor, and we kept destroying the motors. What we decided was we needed a motor built for our needs. So we worked hand-in-hand with Warfield to develop a motor, and we've been continuing to enhance that motor for the last 10 years, and it's becoming popular with EV enthusiasts. And I've been contacted by Chinese manufacturers, and they've tried to clone my motors, and you know, they've offered me prices that are one half of what I can have those motors produced for here in the United States. Warfield Electric has worked with me for 13 years. I wouldn't do that to them, and I wouldn't do that to their employees, because their employees are like my employees. They're my, not just my manufacturing facility, they're also my friends.
Everything we make is made in America. This is 200 horsepower motor controller and a 400 horsepower motor controller that we make.
Sebastian Bourgeois is another conference presenter that got into making electric car components because he saw a need based upon his own experience.
I think like most people, once gas prices hit a certain point, about in 2008, I figured there must be a better way. And so I built a car out of existing components and then realized that those components were much more than augmented golf cart technology. And so, went back to engineers I knew, and we got a team together and designed essentially products made specifically for electric vehicles. It's not only a motor controller, but also kind of the heart and soul of an electric vehicle, essentially the link between the battery pack and the motor. It makes sure that the battery pack is okay, the motor's okay, it gives you whatever power you desire. It also enables you to run some automatic transmission functions, spoofing signals. Then you can interface with a lot of the existing systems and make a modern conversion, you know, without compromising things like traction control, stability control, cruise control, ABS brakes. All these systems can remain in place, and we allow, you know, we make that possible with the controller.
Sebastian Bourgeois' current conversion, a Porsche 911, is a brute.
This is a twin 9 motor setup. This is good to run 400 horsepower, 600 foot-pounds from stall. This is probably, I would say, three times more torque than this car had originally, and you know, easily 2 to 2.5 times more horsepower. So this goes like stink.
Most of the cars on display at the convention were not as sexy as the show cars built by the high-end converters. Jason Horak is a more typical home converter, choosing a 1987 Dodge Daytona for his conversion. He started by setting a price point that was within his means.
Initially, I set my sights at about $15,000 for the whole build. It seemed that was kind of a reasonable price range for a car that would have the kind of performance that I was looking for. I mean, you can build an electric car on a budget for, you know, a lot less money, but I wanted one that could go, you know, 75, 80 miles an hour on the highway. I wanted it to accelerate as quickly as the original car, and, you know, basically be a fun to drive vehicle that I could do all my daily driving in. The projected range is between 100 and 120 miles. That puts it into the realm of practical for most people. And so to be able to get back and forth to work every day, you know, without paying any money for gas, that's kind of cool. Electricity is very inexpensive to charge your car. It's pennies on the dollar.
Electric cars with their limited range make perfect sense as commuter vehicles. You may have noticed that Jason Horak used the term projected range.
I had an issue when I originally came in. My car didn't run, and I shipped it here. So when I got here, there was the owner and operator of Evnetics was under my car fixing it and making it go, and it was just an amazing experience.
While tweaking the controller is something many first-time builders seem to struggle with, most of the build, such as wiring the batteries, is basic electrical knowledge.
These are the batteries, and this is how they're all hooked together. It's really kind of straightforward, but each battery has about 3.4 volts individually. And so in order to get up to a high enough voltage to run a car, you have to hook them together in series.
Can anybody build one? Probably not. But somebody with average or better than average mechanical skills can certainly be very successful at this.
Many people attending the electric car conversion conference are just starting the process.
How many of you are building an electric car but have never driven one yet?
Others had finished their cars in time for the conference and wanted to share what they had learned. At an event open to the public, you could see they also wanted to know more.
First question everybody asks is, how far will it go? On paper, mine should go 80, 75 miles, I think. I finished it 2 weeks ago, and I don't even have that many miles on it yet, so I'm not sure. The other question people ask is, what does it cost? I spent more than I care for my wife to know, but she won't be watching this, so I'll share. It was $25,000.
I wouldn't be surprised if we had $65,000 in building this car.
Even at the lower price range, electric cars at this time are not likely to provide a return on investment that makes them cost competitive with fuel-efficient conventional cars. But that's not what is motivating many of these tinkerers.
When I looked at the unprecedented wealth transfer from the United States to offshore powers that frankly are not friendly, and in many cases are quite interested in our demise, I figured that by making a small contribution to the reduction in the use of fossil fuels, I would be just reducing some of the money going offshore and keeping it here in the United States where it belongs.
Oil is at the center of the struggle of controlling resources. So I'd like to be able to enable an easy way out of that, for one. You have the obvious pollution issue, and they're fun. They're absolutely amazing. Just yesterday, I rode this BMW, and the experience was truly exhilarating. So they don't have to be these little putster, you know, little cars that barely move. They're actually incredibly fun and fast.
Right now, there is a market for electric cars and the products needed to make them that's wide open.
So there's a lot of opportunities, and a lot of the attendees here at the show have already developed products, motors, controllers, chargers, pedals, just instrumentation, things that you need in any vehicle, but some of those have got to be specific to electric vehicles, and we're really seeing a push for people to have a business, not only in products, but also in converting cars.
What I want to do is make electric conversions such as these as a profession.
This is why Wayne Alexander, who's done close to 150 conversions since 2005, was invited to present. Like car painting entrepreneur Earl Scheib, who used to advertise he would paint any car for $29.95, Alexander will convert any car starting at $12,500.
But the $12,500 is the lowest in the country. And I like Earl Scheib. I'll convert any car, any color, any size, starting at $12,500.
I think Wayne Alexander has a lot to share. He has a very simple process of doing this.
We haven't even scratched the surface of electric vehicles in this country. Even if it came to the point of 1% of the vehicles on the road were converted to electric, it'd be a huge amount.
George Hamstra is even more bullish than Alexander about electric cars.
This is the next opportunity, like personal computers. As a matter of fact, it appears to me, after seeing the turnout here in Cape Girardeau and what's going on, that this is going to exceed the growth curve of personal computers.
You may recall that PCs got less expensive and faster. Software was developed that met the needs of consumers and businesses, and companies that dominated the mainframe computer market fell by the wayside. So don't be surprised if electric vehicles become more and more viable, fueled by leaps in battery technology or other innovations. These are unlikely to come from major car companies. It's more likely that the next Steve Jobs or Bill Gates is among this crowd, and that's what EVTV is banking on.
We're still at the phase where this industry is being developed at a grassroots level, and that again is what's really exciting for us, because we don't know where the next Google or Facebook or something is going to come from.
This message resonates with the EVTV audience.
I like the idea of being able to do something that the big companies can't. It's kind of a thumbing my nose at the man.
Even if you're not ready to make an electric car, there's a lot to think about in this story. Wasn't George Hamstra totally inspiring by his choice not to outsource? It's no wonder Jack Rickard selected him to be the keynote speaker. We'd like to thank Jack Rickard and Brian Noto for inviting us in. And if you would like to see what ETV Motorworks is doing, simply go to www.evtv.me and check them out.
You can also visit our website at WSIU.org to watch or share with others the online version of the segments we air, including this overview of ETV Motorworks and the buzz surrounding homegrown electric cars.
As always, we encourage you to make it a point to join us here each week on WSIU In Focus to learn something new and perhaps to even be inspired.
Video copies of this program are available. To order, call our customer service department at 618-453-6184.
Well, he did an excellent job.
I think so, too. I thought it was quite well done.
The story
was good. When
yeah.
you have media guys, TV guys or mailing guys or whatever, that don't, and this is why, as a form of media, we build cars. And the reason is, we think you have to walk the walk.
Got to make sausage. You got to be making sausage.
If you haven't made sausage, your opinion about how to make sausage is pretty limited.
Yeah, don't tell the sausage maker.
Right. But here was a case of a guy who's not on the inside of it, and I thought captured the essence of it quite accurately.
Mm-hmm. I did too.
He got why our people are doing this.
Mm-hmm. Yes, he did.
He understands that it's and in a world of all this flurry of press releases and so forth with the OEMs, he understood that this might also be important. In fact, this might be as important.
Right, as important as
as those releases.
Right.
By the time he gets the video done, it starts to look that way.
That's right. Yeah, it really did.
The OEMs are struggling. They're looking around.
Yeah, that's right. By March now, look what's happened. Yeah.
And it explained our show and the gathering and why people mm-hmm. do this, I thought, very well.
I did, too.
We're going to do it again. This March of last year was when we started this. We just started uh-huh. talking about a little meeting and put it up on the website where people can register. We're open again, and we need you to register mm-hmm. Now.
Absolutely.
So we know to have it.
And they've got a little discount right now, too.
Yes, yeah. they do, yeah. till the 1st of June.
Yeah.
The registration on this is going to be $595. This is not a free show. It's 4 or 5 days, and the guys ask somebody that came why that is, and they'll explain it to you, and it'll be more believable.
Talk to somebody that came here.
When you turn and need a cup of coffee, you hold out your hand. Somebody will hand you a cup of coffee. If you need a beer, you hold out your hand. If you need to be fed, you hold out your hand, and somebody will put it in your hand.
That's right.
We've got that. Brian did that a very down. Good job of organizing all that, where we didn't have to spend any goofy time organizing meals. The meals were there. The drinks were there. The coffee was there.
Yeah,
because we don't have enough time to fool around with
right, the day's not
going
long
to
enough.
The Village Inn and working this right. out with a waitress.
Right, yeah, day's not long
that
enough.
That ain't happening.
No.
So it's a professional conference, not an amateur club. We've done this before. There are reasons, and we'll be happy to explain them to you, but it doesn't matter whether you understand it or not. We've just done it too
right.
long.
Yeah, talk to somebody.
Successfully to go back to doing it stupid.
Yeah, yep.
So it's going to be at the arena. Show Me Center.
Not the Hangar Center Arena.
The Hangar was 18,000 square feet. The Show Me Center Arena is 32,000.
32, yeah. Plus there's
meeting rooms. We're still going to have
things.
Facilities at the Hangar and have our...
We do our racing and everything out there at the airport. Sure.
I don't know when to schedule this, but I want to work in this Cape Girardeau Enduro.
Okay, yeah, we were talking about that. Okay,
it's
yeah.
a very scenic drive. It'll be a 126-mile loop. I have to go drive it and make sure, you know, everything's... we'll have to organize waypoints or something, but it's an interesting drive and an interesting concept to have a loop just a little too big for an electric car.
Right, right. That'll kind of sort it out. Or you build some cars with long range.
The Society of Automotive Engineers, SAE, today invited me to speak at their event.
Oh, they've got their thing coming up, don't
in
they?
September.
Yeah, they've got their meeting, don't
now,
they?
Now, I'm assuming that they're not September 26th to the 30th, because my response to him was, okay, I'll come talk at yours, and you come talk at mine.
Okay. But we don't know the date, huh, of their event?
Right. But I gave him the date of ours.
Okay, okay.
Exactly. Yeah. And speaking on the 27th or 28th, we of course want to know about level 3 charging.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And what they're doing.
Yeah,
that.
What they're doing.
And by
yep.
September, that should be a pretty hot topic.
I think so.
And so I think all that will work out. So I'll go talk at theirs as long as it's not on the 20th.
Not on the show dates. That's right.
From Monday on, I'm kind
through,
of a turkey.
Yeah, Monday through Sunday. Yeah.
But. Any other time, if it's in September, I will try to go talk at theirs.
Okay,
and
good.
So we'll
good
swap. And,
okay, we'll kind of exchange hostages?
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
Sebastian Bourgeois of Evnetics has already expressed support. We're trying to talk him into, he's got a dealer network he's wrestling with, and it's growing by leaps and bounds. And we've offered to host a dealer meeting for him.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know how that's going to come together, but where all the Evnetics dealers can come in a private meeting and get the word from Seb what's coming.
Okay.
And who's going to be cut and who's going to be kept.
That's right.
And how they're going
how they're going to do it.
Do
huh?
all that
cool.
In
cool.
the future.
Good deal.
And so that... but I haven't got word that that's actually going to happen.
Okay.
But
okay.
Sebastian wants to
okay, good.
Be there and
that'd
support
nice. Yeah,
the
great.
The thing. George wants a big hamster, or keynote speaker from last year. We'll be back speaking again and wants to be a big part of the convention.
Mm-hmm.
I think I'm going to have a couple of the Chinese battery guys there.
Good.
Now, they may be incomprehensible, but they'll be here.
That's
talking.
Okay. That'll be fun.
Right.
memorable and remarkable.
I've tasked Brian to get someone from A123 to come tell us. Let us poke pins in them. I don't know if that's going to happen.
We're not quite sure if that's going to work out. But we'll give it the college
you
try.
You have to invite
him. Well, we've got to invite him, absolutely.
And since we're
we've been
using
having so much
ourselves
fun with
anyway.
This year.
And actually, I'm shaping up probably to be one of their larger distributors, yeah, whether they know that, it
they
or
don't
not.
Know it. That's the slightest
here in the
idea.
United States, anyway.
And, it's funny how things work out.
strange bedfellows. But, and so I heard from a guy today that's wanting to know if a Polaris something or other qualify. Now, we are going to have people bring OEM cars, and that's fine.
Mm-hmm.
Our competitions, they will be display only. Our competitions... at the car show, the autocross, the drag race, and so forth.
Yeah, they'll just be exhibit only. And
they'll be exhibit only.
Right.
But if you want to bring your Tesla or your Polaris buggy or any of that, we're going to discount the registration from the $595 to $99 if you trailer or otherwise ship.
You know, bring a vehicle down.
Significant and interesting vehicle of any type that's electric drive.
Yeah, lithium-ion powered electric drive, absolutely.
And so we want to have kind of a show of force of electric cars. I'm not going to ban Volts and Leafs. They're electric, even though the Volt, you have a place where you put the gasoline. But
you know it has gasoline.
The idea is to get them all together and where people can look at them and compare them and compare them. What we found is that these electric cars, sometimes it's like the 12 blind men with the elephant.
Right.
Everybody's feeling it up and describing a different experience.
Right.
This guy's accelerating from 0 to 35 in 25 seconds. And thinks it's good.
Think it's fast, yeah. Anybody else doing that?
And,
No.
Right, so,
no one's that slow.
It's a good opportunity to compare your builds and subject it to the review of your peers. And,
get some ideas
and some critique. Mm-hmm. As Jason Horak said in the little video, by the time he got here, his broken car that he'd shipped the guy who had invented his controller was under the car was working on it.
Was replacing the controller, that's right.
He was replacing the controller. It was a spare that we had.
We had a spare controller.
Oh, well. We got your car going, Jason. And now he reports that he drives it daily.
Cool. Good deal.
A little Dodge.
Yep.
Just not a problem.
And you guys are going to make a lot of friends, too. Everybody that came last time, I mean, is in contact with each other. That's a cool thing, too. It just keeps going.
That's actually the main benefit of the event is not us or what we do. In fact, as it goes along, this will go from year to year, we'll be more and more the coffee pourers and pastry writers.
Right, it'd be you guys. It's your show.
And your show is where you interact with each other.
Right.
But I heard from Mark Eamon today. With the winery at St. Michael's. He's working
Maryland.
On his 914 and going to bring it. But
cool.
He is exporting wine to China now.
It's a big market.
Well, he can't fill that funnel.
Really? Wow.
Yes.
See, the middle class buying everything.
Selling like crazy over there.
They want gas. They want wine.
That's right. So there's an unexpected connection.
That's something.
You know, get interested in EVs and have to deal with the Chinese, and next thing you know,
you're selling wine.
Well. So we're getting at the season where we're going to kick off the Electric Vehicle Conversion Convention, EVCON, 2012. It's scheduled for September 26th through the 30th. Mm-hmm. And I guess it's now a tradition, since we've done it once before, that we'll have the shop open from Monday morning.
I guess, yeah.
To work on your cars.
Yeah, please don't show up before Monday morning, though.
Yeah. Actually, we had two guys Sunday.
We did on Sunday, I know.
Steve Conley is one of our most faithful supporters from Arizona. He gives me $10 every single week.
I know, isn't that something?
And he showed up in a Prowler Sunday.
Yes, right.
And we were at a Hot Rod show downtown, and he came down looking for us.
Down there,
and while he was parking, they gave him a trophy.
Here's a trophy.
That's funny. You win.
He was a winner already. Everybody's a winner.
Everybody's a winner. And so but we're going to be bigger and better. The arena should let us have a large, fairly unlimited vendor exhibit area, and a nice big presentation area. We're still going to mostly be one track.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not going to try to do an ISP con. You know, 3 wide, 25 wide speakers. But we will have some significant educational sessions about controllers, motors, brushes, chargers, and design considerations when you're building your cars, and question and answer sessions, and various personages as we can obtain.
We can wrestle up, that's right.
And speak at the event. And so we'll do the best we can to have a good program with that, and that's usually pretty good.
It was very good. Yep, it was very informative.
And with some good events, a car show, autocross, quarter mile drag race, and maybe a Cape Girardeau Enduro.
Yeah, some type of parade and Enduro. Yeah,
a parade. Yes,
chances for people to see your cars. You know, it's always fun.
So we hope we won't participate. We're going to discount that to $400 till the 1st of June.
Yes, and that's up on the site now, guys.
It is, and get registered. If you can bring a car, it's $99, and that's by way of salute to the not insignificant expense many of them undergo.
If you have to transport it. Yeah.
And back, which a lot of people do. Some can drive their electric cars.
Mm-hmm.
They have to stop and charge a lot.
Maybe there'll be a caravan.
David Rybnik, I think, drove his Tesla from Tennessee. Didn't have a problem. For most of us, that's a fairly arduous trip. And so We're going to recognize that with a discount. Last year, we recognized it with a huge discount.
Yeah, a little too
so
much.
Huge that we had people signing up, and then we'd never hear from them again. They didn't have enough skin in the game.
Right, they didn't finish their vehicles
or
something.
So we're going to fix that.
Yeah. But, other than that, that was it. Yeah, it was good. Yeah,
if I get your $99, I'll at least probably find out what happened to you.
That's right. At least you have a story.
I'll get a story out of it. Right. So, again, we want to express our appreciation to David Kidd
yes,
at WSIU.
Thanks,
that was an excellent overview and kind of took us out of ourselves and back to,
to see what we look like. Yeah, what we're doing too.
And he wants to work on some future projects.
Yes.
And we're going to accommodate that to the fullest extent mm-hmm. that we can with David. And maybe he can teach us a few things about
videography.
He's been doing it for some time.
Yeah.
And we'll share with him what we know about electric vehicles and, and batteries.
That's it.
And, so until next week, we'll try again. Maybe in about a week.
Okay.